As a data revolution completely revolutionizes the way we live and operate in today's world, data generation, collection, and its usage has a whole new meaning. So how is technology impacting the socio-cultural fabric of the society in the neoliberal world? We hope to find answers to this question and many more in our third plenary for the day. Mr. Bibhu Mishra, IT editor, Business Standard, is the esteemed moderator for this session. Our distinguished panel also includes speakers, Mr. Pratap Reddy, Additional Director General, Karnataka Police, Mr. Parminderjeet Singh, Executive Director, IT for Change, and Dr. G. Srinivasaragan, Professor, IIIT, Bangalore. I invite you all on stage, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, wish you a very good afternoon and welcome to the plenary session on engineering social values in a data science-driven world. As the name suggests, we are going to delve deeper into this topic. We have a very eminent panelist with us, starting from someone who has spent in industry and now an academician, Professor Raghavan, Mr. Parminder Singh, who is part of an NGO called IT for Change, and he has been championing how the use of ICT for the upliftment of the society. He is with us, and Mr. Reddy, a senior IPS officer. He is being part of law enforcement agency. He is going to give us a different perspective. So let me start with a simple anecdote. Being a journalist, I'll tell you this incident happened some 6 years ago in 2010. Many of you living in Bangalore may be knowing that that time a massive fire broke out in one of the towers in old airport road called Carlton Towers. So those days, we used to see the visuals of people jumping out of the window. And towards evening, being a business journalist, perhaps it was not much of interest for me. But towards evening, when the we get to know a few names who are the deceased, and but their identity was not revealed. So because I had gone there earlier, I had met many business leaders there. So it struck me, perhaps any of those have been impacted. So I did search their names in various social media platforms. I used LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, all sorts of platforms to find out, to get their identity. And at the end of the, in next half an hour or 1 hour, almost I found, how three members from one investment banking company were part of the died in that unfortunate incident. Two members from an IT company. The point I'm saying that how data in various whether it's structured or unstructured way, if you correlate it, if you if you can combine the disjointed element, a lot of insights it will give it to you. And that was some 2010. Now we are in 2016 when there massive penetration of smartphones, internet has spread quite a lot. Social media has taken, has gone viral. So there are a lot of data which is generated in every platform. So how to use that data? So that data can be used for getting insights, for better decision making. You can sort the data, mine the data to address specific audience. But at the same time, if the data can be in the hand of the elements, they can that can result in a breach of privacy. It can be lead to law and order situation. So let me begin with one question to the esteemed panelists and I request them all to speak on this for a few minutes. If the emergence of data sciences, is it a boon or bane for the society in the Indian context? If the data science being leveraged for bad or good, ethical or unethical purpose? So I request Dr. Reddy to start with, Mr. Reddy to start with, and then.
Yeah, thank you, Bibhu, and thanks for the fellow panelists. And let me begin with a disclaimer, because I, being from law enforcement, from a professional perspective, look at things entirely differently, and as an individual, one would look at differently. But what at the end of the conversation, what I would like to place before you is, the conversation is not as much black and white as one tends to argue that whether data science is a boon or a bane. It is a zone of gray which keeps the boundaries of which would keep changing depending on how you look at it from a particular perspective. So during my initial remarks, let me give you a few anecdotal examples of this thing. Now, many of you maybe from outside of Bangalore, as you move out of this hotel in the evening to go back to your respective hotels or your friend's place, you would log on to your Google map and try to find the location and how much time it takes. Now, the Google Maps driving directions, as it evolved over the last few years, today the Google driving directions will ensure that, it will ensure that you are clearly being told that where the major bottleneck of traffic is happening, where it is highly congested, and where, how you are going to be advised, which roads are to be avoided, and what is to be done. Now, can any one of you tell me, or like all of us are aware, that all this data is being generated from each one of us? When Google is giving us a very intelligent driving direction, saying that this is what is happening and this is how you need to travel, please avoid this bottleneck, means the data anonymized, or like huge data components that are available on the platform, are used to give you a experience which you relish. Now, I take it to the other side. I have been additional commissioner of police of Bangalore city till December. We sitting in the city police control room and the traffic control room, you don't have access to these kind of huge data analytics at the back end. Let me propose before you, tomorrow one of the local law enforcement agencies, one of the national law enforcement agencies says that, see, to provide you a better experience and ensure that the traffic police are able to do a better job, please allow us access to all the analytics. So from your smartphones, whatever traffic is being generated, is it okay for you? The straight reaction I can very easily anticipate is no, we are not going. But whereas when it happens with Google, when you say you are accepting the cookies and when you are accepting the terms of conditions, you don't have any issue in giving your personally identifiable information and data. I am not specific to Google. Google is only to just draw your attention as an example. It can be any service provider. So when it comes to private corporations, we don't have too many issues in allowing the data to be taken by them and taken and made use of. But when it comes to public services and national governments, there is a huge question marks that arise. So this I would like to leave the thought before you. Number two, today in economic times, if you have seen like InMobi, so there's a company which has been penalized in United States of America by a few million dollars for, making and collecting the information in an unauthorized way from its clients for targeted advertising purposes. Similarly, last year, I think if you remember, the Airtel in the browser, there is an injected version where it kept on collecting the data and subsequently quietly, though initially Airtel said that this is all for making your browser experience better and the data usage more efficient, but subsequently when the hue and cry was raised, the data was removed. So these are some of the issues that I would like to place before you and try to compare it. And second is, recently if people from Karnataka would be aware now, how the law enforcement and governments which are needed to deliver criminal justice services and better services to the citizens, find it extremely difficult to do it. Like, the pre-university course question papers leaked in Karnataka. The examination was cancelled twice. It affected 6.44 lakhs of students. their careers, their future with respect to their common entrance examinations for the medical, engineering and all got affected. The reputation of the government suffered. Now, as we kept on probing the, during the investigation, we suddenly realized that WhatsApp as a medium played such an important role to distribute these leaked question papers and thereby compromising the entire educational system and the examination system that is happening here. Now, as all of us are aware, it's next to impossible from the end-to-end encrypted systems of WhatsApp for any investigating agency as of now to get into it and go down step by step backwards to where it originated and how this compromise in the question paper has taken place. Now, as responsible individuals and citizens, do we see an issue in this? That while on one side privacy is a very, very cherished goal and cherished right that is envisioned in various constitutions and by the judgments of the highest courts of the land, but at the same time, the constitution also says that there are reasonable restrictions when it comes to data. Now, as I said, the zone of gray, like what are the reasonable restrictions, then can be different arguments and how and where you are going to draw the line. But I begin with the argument and proposition before you that it is data analytics is a necessary tool and it is as much a necessary evil which both the private corporations and law enforcement would continue to necessarily use. And how and where we are going to draw the line, I think it would keep as an evolving question and the answers would also keep evolving. Thank you.
Starting from the question that the moderator been asked about whether data sciences analytics is good or bad, and obviously we all agree it's not one or the other. But the question then is what, how do we, you know, make the distinction? And this directly takes us to the question of how privacy has been seen on one side and data as having economic, social, and security value has been seen. And there are two different sets of people who see it in this manner. The privacy guys look at what can be said as a data denial situation. They say, let's data not be generated at all. So if there's no data generation, then we are safe. So close the pipes entirely. There's no data leakage, and that's what should be. On the other side, we live in a world where increasingly artificial intelligence, algorithms, big data are basic to most business and social systems. And therefore, there's an enormous economic value which is coming out from it. The question is that who takes the decision? And I'm right now open that somebody takes the decision that, yes, we will forego this economic, political, security value and save our data. Now, even the people who talk a lot about privacy do take the economic value, whether it is in exchange from Facebook's services or Google services, as Mr. Reddy was saying, or from the state in terms of securing them. So I think it's no longer possible for people to have these discussions in silos as it is going, because privacy earlier used to mean very different thing, and that had its legal frameworks around it. It was working well. But today, when data is the fuel of value in almost every system, whether we are going to decide that we are going to forego all this value is itself a political decision to take. But that should be discussed in that manner. What value would we forego? I then therefore do not mean that the person who's making value, whether it is a security people or the business people, have unregulated access to that value. And somebody has to say this, but not this. Those decisions have to be taken. And I think we need to take our framework to a higher level to understand how data is changing the society. The question, the name of the session about how data-fed societies, how social values are brought into the data-fed societies. I would very quickly go back. I know this is the next session, which is on philosophical reflections, but for me, it is a necessity to try to put things in framework to establish why we need to step back in a political, social, and ethical manner to see what is data doing here. Human beings were born with some physical power and some intelligence, and then civilization made progress. Human beings made tools which improved their physical power. And then we had the Industrial Revolution for first time when power got disembodied into machines. And for the last 200 years, we are having this age of mechanization of everything. We know that it was inevitable when we had those kind of power of mechanization that everything would not get mechanized. And we know in 200 years, everything has got mechanized. In the same way, human beings have been using aids to intelligence for many, many years. But this is the first time when intelligence gets disembodied. And then we have artificial intelligence. As we had artificial power when Industrial Revolution started, we now have intelligence which is artificial. And that would at least be as big a change as when we had disembodied power, which was the mechanization. As mechanization took over the last 200 years, artificial intelligence is going to take over the next decades and the centuries. And the change was so dramatic, I will only briefly touch upon it. Artificial power brought us capitalism because there was no other way to organize society's relationships. The feudal method could not organize large-scale machinery, and then capitalism came along. Now we are starting when intelligence is getting disembodied. Artificial intelligence is going to change all social systems, and we're talking about that kind of huge change society-wide. I'm just trying to touch upon the subject that it's not longer possible to see it from a security angle and a businessman looking at it from a business angle and a human rights guy looking at a privacy angle. This is something which is huge. The change is big. We are only seeing the small dots. The picture is not fully formed, and that's not that I claim that I can see the picture, but as long as we start looking at it, knowing that we need to look at a big picture, and the society steps back and starts deciding big issues about what is privacy versus economic value. This is question number one. And since there is a lot of economic value, how economic value would be appropriated? Mr. Reddy was giving an example that Google uses data provided by all of us to make economic value out of it. The same people deny that value to the security agencies, which is fine. I'm not making a comment whether it's good or not. But who should have the benefit of that value? Whether the individual should get it, whether the state as a representative of a collective should get it, how much of it can be monetized, how value will be appropriated, the enormous, endless value which comes from the AIfication of all social systems, what kind of political economy frameworks would determine their appropriation is the kind of level to which we have to rise, and we then locate all the issues of privacy, security, business, etc. While we keep on doing the battles as we do, as the business does, as the privacy advocates do, I'm not saying suspend those battles, but also step back as a society and look at the larger picture. And there should be a social political process of developing the principles of what is privacy, why security is important, how economic value would be appropriated, who owns the value which comes out of data, how that would be distributed. These are the big issues which should inform our actions in separate spaces. Thank you.
Hi. I guess there's really no debate on whether all this big data, AI, machine learning technology is good or bad. I found this very interesting quote by none other than Albert Einstein. I think it's very relevant. So this is something that he said in 1965. The release of atomic power has changed everything except our way of thinking. The solution to this problem lies in the heart of mankind. If only I had known, I should have become a watchmaker. So this is, I mean, that the advent of nuclear power was there. Again, I mean, one could use it for killing people, one could use it for peaceful purposes, nuclear energy, whatever. And obviously nobody foresaw what all could be done with the nuclear power. It was there, there was an impending requirement, and it was used and for once, and thankfully never afterwards. And I think we are pretty much at the cusp of exactly the same kind of earth-shattering change. And we really don't know how to handle this this new AI thingy that is sort of emerging. Now, the thing is, okay, so if at all you want to have any framework around trying to govern this thing, there are huge amount of challenges in trying to even lay out or think about a framework that you might want to use to regulate this. First, even the notion of privacy, I mean, we've all been talking about privacy, but privacy at the end of the day is something very, very personal. What means privacy to me is certainly not necessarily what means privacy to someone else, right? So they might be, and even for me, there are contexts in which I would be very happy to share a particular piece of data. There are some other contexts in which I would not be happy sharing the same data. So it's not so much about the data itself. It is, I'm more worried about how it is actually going to be used by somebody else. And in some context, I'm very, very happy. In some other context, I'm really not, right? I mean, if somebody is going to look at my health record and maybe suggest alerts, preventives, whatever, I'm actually happy. I don't mind sharing the data if that's the sort of feedback I'm going to get. But then if the same data, if it is used by somebody else to decide whether to give me a job or not, I mean, to make it very trivial, then I'm not really happy. I mean, that's really not the way I want this data to be used, right? So the even the notion of privacy is very, very hard to define. And coming from someone who's been working on machine learning and stuff like that, even trying to, I mean, there is, obviously the immediate thought would be that if you want to ensure privacy, you bring in, make data as anonymized as possible. Now, it's actually not as simple as it sounds. Even anonymization is very, very nebulous, to say the least. I mean, I'll give you one quick example. There is, I mean, many of my students, they routinely participate in these data competitions and hackathons and stuff like that. So this was one of the recent competitions that was posted in this popular platform called Kaggle. I'm sure most of you must be aware of that. So there was this competition on trying to predict the hotel which a potential traveler is likely to book. So this competition was actually hosted by a travel company, and they had given about 4 crore data points of people who had, and everything about the data set was completely anonymized. So there was a location, country, continent, all of these were just numbers. So there was a location ID, there was a country ID, continent ID, there was the ID of the destination which these people booked their travel to, and so on, right? So everything was completely anonymized. And now it turned out that very soon, the people, the participants, actually figured out a very smart way to actually zero in on the precise latitude and longitude of every one of those user IDs. And the giveaway in that entire data set was there was a field called the origin to destination distance. Okay? And with just that, they actually managed to come up with smart algorithm. I mean, that, like the I'll see one thing that has very clearly changed that we have is that we have enormous computing power at our disposal. I mean, the people who participate in these competitions, I mean, you would be amazed at the kind of computing power they have at their disposal. They this particular competition, the person who won it was claiming that they had actually used a cluster which had 700 GB of RAM. Okay, and they were running this computation for 2 full days, and finally they actually managed to compute the precise, within a couple of miles, the latitude and longitude of every single user ID in the entire database. Now, there was absolutely nothing in the data, in the entire 4 crore data set, which you would have even suspected is a giveaway. But then, here is an algorithm which will actually give you the latitude and longitude of every person involved. So, now, is this breach of privacy? Well, if you look at it one way, it is. But then, when you gave the data, you never suspected that somebody could actually discover where you live by just looking at the data. So even this notion of anonymization is very, very nebulous. It's very hard for you to say what is enough, what is not enough, what a potential hacker can actually use in some smart way to figure out whatever they want about you. So this is the basic point I'm making, is that anonymization is not as simple as it seems. Okay, and like, for instance, there is the statistics that I've come across that just the zip code and the date of birth is apparently a unique identifier for more than 87% of the US population, right? So just removing a unique ID like, say, Aadhaar or the social security number or your name and address is actually no guarantee that somebody cannot figure out, if they really want to, everything about you, okay? So, so privacy is, we really don't know what that means in today's context. And the one very big change from what was the sort of data that we were used to maybe till a decade ago and what is really happening now is that most of the data that we have seen in the past was historical, was aggregated, was kind of fossilized. I mean, it was, but you really couldn't use the data to make any decision going forward. But today's data is actually very different. The sort of data that we're talking about is live, real time. It is out there. I mean, as we speak, there is the Ola cab I took from home to come here has actually given away a lot of my data, and God knows who's going to use it in what way, right? So every single activity we do on our devices when we step out is out there for people to see, right? So there is, I mean, this gives us enormous power, but at the same time, as I said earlier, it could potentially be misused. Now, where we draw the line, how we draw the line is very, very hard to say. The only concluding remark I would make here is that I guess at the end of the day, an abolitionist view on this is probably, I mean, it would be very similar to the usual adage that we hear, throwing the baby with the bathwater, right? So if you take the view that data is bad, then I don't think we will progress as a society. I mean, this is a huge change, and it is largely for the better. But then, yes, there is a bad side, and we need to figure out a way to sort of put a check on the bad side. And my personal view, much of this check has to be not top down by either the law enforcement agencies or the government. It has to be more bottom up. given the sort of data that we have today, the bottom up is each one of us as individuals who let out our data knowingly or unknowingly, we need to, there needs to be some enabling mechanism which the government or the law enforcement agencies put in place for us to be able to govern our own data, right? So, maybe something like a data trail or data trace of, so can I, is there a place where I can actually see where all my data has gone, in what form, what it is being used for, blah, blah, blah. And can I cut some of those cords if I don't want it to be used that way? Okay, so if there are certain enablers of that kind, it is that, I think, which will probably a good deterrent for malicious or unintended use of the data. Top-down control is very, very unlikely to work, and precisely for the same reason that our panelist here had hinted at, like the WhatsApp thing, right? So if everything is encrypted, then what do you do? And in this case, clearly, the top-down policies are almost entirely powerless to do much. Right.
Thank you, Professor Raghavan. Hello. So, Mr. Reddy actually touched upon the subject about how for an Indian company which is into business of mobile advertisement, how tracking of location is important, and the primary market is the US, and if they are collecting the location of the users for that, if they have not taken the permission from them, and as per the law of the land, they are guilty and they have to pay the fine. And that is US, and most of the European countries, we know even the privacy law is much more stringent than the US, than any other country. Given that, because all our panelists are discussing about the issue of privacy, what is privacy to us may not be, you know, to the other person. How important it is, to have a well-defined law to govern privacy, to identify privacy, what it is, especially at a time when we are living in a app-driven world. We are talking about app economics. Every other day we are seeing some apps. An average smartphone users uses some 30 apps nowadays. Many of these apps collect our personal information, and after a few months, 5 months, 6 months, we'll say they're suddenly out of market. But they have access to huge data, and unconfirmed reports say these people sell this data for profit, which was not their original intention. So given that, how to tame this, if I can start with Mr. Reddy, Mr. Singh.
Honestly, I don't have an answer like how to tame, so possibly except saying that I think we need to evolve towards that, and a lot of efforts are being made, and maybe Europe holds a good example to say, particularly as far as privacy is concerned, then after that US has, but the challenge what we, and let me again come back and draw upon my experience from law enforcement and government, is that one of the fundamentals we talk about whenever we are talking about cyberspace and all that, the lack of geographical restrictions on the flow of data. So whenever we download an app and start using it, and like where this company is hosting its servers, and how and where this your data is traveling and all that, none of us are aware. Now, from a perspective of enforcing, be it contract, be it law, or whatever it is, all these are geography bound. So if you are a private company and you want to enforce some contract on a particular company, they are bound by Indian geography if you are living in India and signed a contract. If I am a law enforcement agency, I am bound by Indian geography as far as enforcing and trying to implement and invoke the law for criminal action. But as all of us are aware that you, the cloud services offered by say Amazon or some other big company are far, far cheaper when I host my data, and when you start a small startup company or any company, it will be far cheaper and at a marginal and fraction of cost, you will be able to host your entire data in some foreign land where you don't know except your contract, what you sign, and all the terms and conditions what you sign. But God forbid tomorrow something happens to the company and the data, and one of your employee walks out with the entire data, and you come and walk into one of our cybercrime police stations and please, sir, please enforce this this thing as per IT Act. This is, but the unfortunate part is we just don't have any jurisdiction to summon the server which is being hosted in a faraway country. So this is one part of it. So privacy is, as I said, like I think there are no easy answers and no easy solutions, and what somebody calls it as a privacy, somebody else may not. So I like long, many years back, almost 8-10 years back in one of the seminars I was attending, there was an example that was quoted, I think it was quoted by a Filipino minister. So what happened is one of the very elderly woman, grandmother type kinds, so she takes a video of her own in full nude and uploads it from Philippines, and then afterwards she travels to United States of America and starts living there. Now, like in India, this is a offense as per the local law. So when the Filipinos wanted to invoke the legal sections and wanted extradition of this old woman, United States said that this is no offense as far as US is concerned. Any consenting adult above 18 years is free to do what she or he wants to do. So this is just to bring the contrast, saying that as a culture and as a country, you may have specific set of laws which criminalizes or decriminalizes a particular offense, like 377, the LGBT rights. So as of now in India, the LGBT and 377 is a criminal offense, but many other countries have decriminalized it and they say that this is no offense. So similarly, the privacy, what privacy in many countries, like in particularly Europe and all that, is not a privacy concern in India. Like it goes with the culture also. It is somebody is unwell in your neighborhood whom you may not really know very well, you would go and console him and talk to him saying that how are you and what. And the neighbor who is in distress would share that, see, I have this problem and this, I have thyroid, I have this thing, I have this problem and all, which in a Western context would be unimaginable because these are extremely private information. Except for the family members, nobody else would ever share. The doctor and the family would never ever share what is the personal problem of an individual. Whereas in India, you can get the entire biography, history of the total family down 7 generations, both sides, and which still is not any privacy concern. So this is what.
Your question about what should be done. I think what should need to be done is to understand that fundamentals have changed in all layers due to this new force called big data, artificial intelligence, working of algorithms, etc. Once we recognize that, what happens, we see that there are new costs and new benefits across the society, across each individual's own life. There are benefits, there are costs. Across the society, there are new benefits, there are new costs. Across social classes, there are new benefits, new costs. Now, it is a job of politics to appropriate costs and benefits across the society. You take political decisions about what is what costs are acceptable, what benefits overweigh the costs, where they do not. These are political decisions. And first of all, if we do not take that decision, and lots of people want to stay away from politics and think that technology will solve it, economics would solve it, or mostly history will solve it. You know, you will get what you deserve. So if these are the solutions, you're going to get what you deserve. The question is, are we today a more deliberate society than we were when the Industrial Revolution came and it gave what we wanted to give in whichever manner, in a historical sense, we got now? Or we are a more deliberate society, we could at least partly chart the way we want it to be charted. The issue is political. We need to figure out what costs we want to take
as an individual, as a social group. And it's not just an individual level thing. It will never succeed if you say that it will be an individual who will be controlling his or her privacy. First of all, it doesn't work. You don't have that kind of skills. Two, it's that prisoner's dilemma thing. Everybody who wants to maximize the benefit there and then would always take the benefit and not the cost issue. It's a decision which everybody together takes, okay, we forego these benefits, but these costs are unbearable and we cannot bear it. Therefore, we would not allow these things. So most of these choices are collective. And I agree with you that the old, and everything has changed, that old sense of privacy no longer means much. I would define now privacy as every data has a potential to do harm. Data's potential to do harm is a privacy problem, and data's potential to do me good is a value issue. So as you were saying, the health data is good if it is used by the doctor, and therefore that is not the privacy issue. If it is used by somebody to harm me, like in job profiling, social profiling, then it's a bad thing. So is the issue is about data, whether it does damage to me or benefits me. One side is the privacy issue, other side is the economic value issue. Who would decide it? Partly the individual should decide it, but largely it would be collective decisions. We need more political thinking. We need to develop principles which will guide how data, what kind of data damages. There would be some kind of data which we have to deny, it should not be collected at all. We would make those decisions also. Some kind of data, even if we are going to have value. And I was arguing with somebody who was saying that big data analytical or mass surveillance is not useful for law enforcement. I said, never give this not useful argument, because finally it is useful, and I know it is useful. But if we don't want some kind of things, it's because of the ethics involved. Even torture is useful because it does get information, but we don't like torture because it's ethically wrong. It's not ineffective. So there would be some kind of data collections which we would say, no, we don't want the pipes to leak. It needs to be end-to-end encryption. But most of these decisions about what ways data can be used, what constitutes a privacy violation, and what is its economic value are larger principles. And also importantly, how value would be distributed, how value would be appropriated. And the last quick issue is that a lot of value today is with private companies. Somebody was giving a presentation how, while government spends so much time doing town zoning, you know, it does many month samples to zone out a town, whether it's a commercial area or a residential area or whatever. One single telecom company in a single day of data can zone out the town simply by telling that in the evening the mobiles are moving in this direction, in the afternoon they're aggregated in this part. Single day, single telecom company can give data which government spent a year collecting. Soon all this data would be in private hands, and no policy and no governance can be done without that data. Would the government go and buy all this data, which is actually people's data, from this company? It will get bankrupt, and that would be the best model for anyone to do it. So we have to restart thinking who would get the value which comes out of data. So these are all big questions, and withdrawing from them politically won't do it. I know we'll all go back and say, okay, well, these things are difficult, we can't do anything about it. And that's not a great attitude to take, in my view. Thank you.
Yeah, so, right, I mean, see, most of the data today, as Parminder rightly said, you don't even know where your data is going. I mean, you have let out a lot of information about yourself. I mean, even if, like, for instance, even if you make a remark on Twitter, there is somebody who's mining Twitter to get that much more information about you, right? So. So it's all out there, and a lot of the data is in large private corporations, and in a way, I think the law enforcement and the government's role would be to make this available, to make this data available for the individual to see, because it's, look, I mean, I don't think we ever had this situation before, where all so-called private information about individuals, it is out there, being collected, okay? And given that this is a situation, there is hardly any framework which will enable me to view my own data. Like I go to Apollo hospitals and for say some checkup, something, there are a bunch of tests done. Then I come back, is that data available for me to be, so tomorrow if I go visit a different doctor, can I actually leverage on the data that was collected about me when I visited Apollo? Today, no, that is not there, right? So when I say the individual must have control on the data, it's essentially of this kind, because it is information about myself which is out there, and I must have some degree of control over it. And it should at least be by way of being able to access it when I want it and be able to use it in the way that I would want to use for myself. So that is one thing, to enable the individual to have access to his or her own data. And the second thing, which is equally important, is to be able to fight if I find there is unauthorized or malicious use of the data that is available about me with somebody else. Today, unfortunately, neither of them is possible, and I mean, simply because all of us are actually learning the game. Both the individuals involved, the law enforcement agencies, government, everybody is sort of taken by surprise, and I'm sure it'll take some time for people to come to terms with this new thing. But thankfully, as of today, it's not, I mean, the discussion is about machine intelligence, data mining, and all of that stuff, but much of the so-called cybercrime, even today, Mr. Reddy can probably correct me, is not because of data mining. I mean, it's still the classical the crime scenario where data is stolen. It's not so much that somebody had data, they actually managed to mine something about you and used it in a malicious fashion. Much of the cybercrime today still seems to be more on the classical lines. I mean, there was this famous case where a lot of almost like 500,000 credit card transactions were sort of stolen, and there was this company called Card Systems. They were actually a transaction processing company, and their only job was to push the transactions through. They were not legally supposed to store any of those transactions. But what they had apparently done was they were sampling some of those transactions, and they were storing it, presumably for research purposes, and so they could sort of figure out why certain transactions are failing and how they could prevent failing transactions and so on and so forth. And that data apparently got stolen by somebody else. Maybe somebody just took the disk and ran away, right? I mean, so a lot of, and so the, well, one could argue that if there was no data mining, nobody would have stored it in the first place, and hence it wouldn't have got stolen, right? But then the thing is, so as of today, I mean, even the hackers are, I guess, learning. I'm sure it'll take a while for serious crimes to happen where data mining is the real culprit. As of now, it's probably not. I guess before the hackers catch on and learn how to use data mining for malicious purposes, hopefully we will get smarter and the government will be able to put better controls in place.
Thank you, Professor Raghavan. It was really wonderful. As you mentioned, I think Mr. Reddy will also agree. Most of the malicious activities in cyber world doesn't happen because of data mining. People are just trying to mine the gold. So
So once they realize the importance of that, perhaps that will happen. We saw something happen in Gujarat recently when the gold merchants data, which was handled by one particular IT company, was leaked. So perhaps it will continue to happen, but we are running sort of time for the next panel. So we could have opened the floor for the question for the audience, from the audience, but I think I have got the indication to wrap it off. But you can always do one-to-one interaction with the panelists on the sidelines. And let me sum it off. I think the esteemed panelists here agreed that data is really important. It is going to have a lot more, going to generate a lot of economic value. Mr. Reddy said that, you know, how data analysis is a necessary tool as much as it's a necessary evil. So what we are seeing is as a necessary tool, and hopefully it will continue to happen. And Mr. Parminder Singh also mentioned how what we are seeing are just dots. So connecting the dots and perhaps the full-formed picture when it emerges, we have to be prepared for that. And we need to be adequately sensitized given the fact that we are a young country, especially in the cyber world. A lot of the users in the cyber world are, you know, they're first-time users, so a lot of, so they need to be adequately sensitized. Given this, I think it's equally, you know, important for the government as well as non-profits like Mr. Parminder's organizations to sensitize the public. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for your kind attention, and it was really a pleasure to, you know, moderating the session. Thank you.